Geraldine Hughes was the legal secretary for the accuser's attorney in the 1993 child molestation accusations. Her book, Redemption, tells the beginning story behind all these allegations.
True talk.
I came to the realization that there was a reason why I was there in 93. God gave Michael Jackson something he didn't give his accuser, and that was a witness. And I literally witnessed them set Michael up. And I will honestly tell you, if it wasn't for the book, no one would have ever known what happened in 93. The book tells about all the characters that were involved in 93. And I don't know if you guys remember Anthony Pelicano.
Yeah.
Anthony was the private investigator. Anthony's in prison right now. And it was so ironic that Anthony Pelicano went to prison the same month that the district attorney finally decided to go on and indict Michael. He wanted to make sure he was out of the way because Anthony Pelicano is really the one that dug up all the facts about the 93 case. It's just that when the case settled, he didn't want any part of the settlement. Cochran came in. Michael's new attorney came in, and they decided to settle. And the reason why they decided to settle is because Johnny Cochran, God bless his soul, God bless his soul, an awesome man in the legal field. But Johnny started out as a civil attorney, a PI attorney. That's all they do is settle. So his expertise was in that area of settling, even though, you know, he did the OJ trial, but most of his expertise is to go in and, you know, let's settle. And so when he came into Michael's case saying, let's settle, Anthony Pelicano did not want any part of the case anymore. And that's when he bowed out, the attorney bowed out. But he was the one that my mom called that we went and talked to about the case. And while we were in there talking to him about the information that I had, he was so glad that we came forward, and he said my mom had the courage to come forward. He had a beautifully autographed picture of Michael Jackson hanging on his wall. He had a lot of high-profile clients, and it's quite possible that the charge that he's in jail for is not his own. But I believe if you really look behind the surface, it was just too much of a coincidence that he was put in jail the same month that Tom Snedden launched a charge against Michael again. Because he was very instrumental in 93 in digging up all the facts. He even went and talked to the boy, had a meeting with the boy, asked the boy face to face, had Michael ever done anything? And Anthony Pelicano, he was an Italian, they call him kind of like a mobster kind of guy, but you know, they may be of that mentality, but they're very family oriented. Anthony Pelicano would not have ever taken on representing Michael if he had a clue that Michael was possibly guilty of harming a child. Their integrity, that's what they're mainly about. So before he even said yes to taking on the case, he went and talked to the boy, and he asked the boy, and he was very gentle with him. You know, he's a very smooth guy. And he said he asked the boy, did Michael do anything inappropriate, anything? Has he ever touched you in any? And he said the boy denied everything, said he never did anything inappropriate. And it was at that point that he decided to take on the case. They first came at us for, they wanted $20 million from Michael Jackson. And they were, the father had a movie interest. He wanted to be a screenwriter. And he was successful in producing, not producing, he was successful in doing a movie. I don't know if you've heard of the movie, Robin Hood, Men in Tights. That movie was, he took the idea of the movie to a producer, well known, if I think of his name, I'll throw it out there. But, and then he was the one that actually made the movie. But the father found out that the most money is made when you're the executive producer. And he wanted the next movie to be the executive producer. So he saw that Michael had a friendship with his son, and not just the son. This has come out at trial that Michael was a friend to that whole family, the mom, the daughter. He didn't take that son anywhere that family was not there. You know, it's just that the boy wanted to, you know, they were, the mom had a daughter, everything she did with the daughter, so it was Michael and the son were like, you know, he was kind of like striking a balance in that family. giving the boy a father figure to relate to. And when he didn't pay the money and he refused to, you know, to be a victim of the extortion attempt, when he didn't pay the money, the father did just what he said he was going to do. He said, I'm going to destroy you. He said, if I don't get what I want, I'm moving according to a plan. Anthony Pelicano got hold of a tape recorded conversation where he was verbally saying this to another person, I'm going to destroy him if I don't get what I want. And then the stepfather actually said, well, how's that going to help your son? He said, I don't care about that. You know, it was only about the money. And then from being on the inside, you know, I talk about there was a court hearing, a custody hearing. A lot of people didn't know that. Where the father had the child, the mom, and wouldn't return him. And the mother wanted the child back, so she took him to court. She got an ex parte hearing. They went to court. The father had been negotiating with Michael for the $20 million like about 3 weeks, almost a month prior to that hearing. So the knowledge was already there. But when they went to court, and they even filed papers, they filed rebuttal papers. When they filed those rebuttal papers, I remember typing, there was no mention in those papers about there was even a suspicion that Michael was molesting the child was at risk or anything. They just didn't know that the court was going to grant full custody of that child back to the mom and order them to return the boy. And I remember this date like it was yesterday, because I'm in the office saying, I'm waiting to find out how this hearing is going to turn out. I'm all nosy and everything. And the day that they went to court and the judge ordered them to return the boy back to the mom, that was the day, instead of returning the boy back, that was the day that the father took the boy to the psychologist. They had already planned that that was how they were going to report it, because none of them could pass the character test. I was the one that typed the letter where the letter was telling the father how to report child molestation or child abuse by using a third party. There's a chapter in here called the third party witness. And so he had already had it planned. He sent the letter to the father. He had the whole thing, you know, planned up. And then the other part that's kind of interesting is my attorney had represented a lady prior to this, and this lady was trying to get custody of her children in a divorce action, and she wanted to guarantee full custody. My attorney had her charge the father with child molestation. And sure enough, you know, you go to court, you guys have read these reports. As soon as she mentioned that, she got full custody of her children. And this happened just before the Chandler case came. So he had already tried and tested he had already put it to the test, and it worked just perfectly. The media has been very clever in disassociating him from the black community. But when you go and see what he's been doing behind the scenes that he's never wanted any credit for, he's our biggest supporter from Africa, of our mother country, Africa. He's the number one biggest supporter of our black colleges, always has been. He's never wanted any credit for this, you know. And I said, well, if that's not black, I don't know what is.